Hi, this is Jim Starkweather, the publisher of Kitnaker Network and Aeroscale.com, and welcome to another episode of Cracking the Box. Today we have from Revell the F-4G Phantom 2 Wild Weasel. This is a 1/32nd scale kit. It is a new release. I believe the kit was released prior to this, though, so this is an updated release, basically. The camo and marking scheme you can see on the box is kind of a tribute plane to the lifetime of the F-4, serving from 1963 in combat or in the air till they were phased out in 1996. That's in the U.S. Air Force, of course. They still flew for a while in other air forces. Now, the Wild Weasel, if you're not familiar with it, is a anti-ground-based missile detector / interceptor system, or I guess attacker. I'm not an expert on the aircraft, so let's go ahead and take a brief look at its history. The F-4 Phantom II was developed as a long-range supersonic jet interceptor fighter-bomber aircraft. The original order in the early 1950s came from the U.S. Navy, but it was later modified for the U.S. Marines and the U.S. Air Force. The first test flight of the F-4 Phantom II was in May of 1958. It saw service in Vietnam as both a ground attack fighter and in air-to-air combat. The F-4 could reach a maximum speed of over Mach 2.2 and could carry 18,000 pounds of weapons. However, the F-4 did not have an internal mounted gun. Instead, it used a cannon mounted on a wing hardpoint. The F-4 is the last U.S. fighter to attain ace status in air-to-air combat. The F-4G Wild Weasel V was one of the last variations, and it was equipped with the capability to suppress enemy air defenses. In the last years of service, the F-4G played a key role in Operation Desert Storm. Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed the little bit of background information on the plane. I certainly learned a lot, and we'll move on with unboxing the kit. You can see this one is marked for ages 12 plus. It's a pretty big box, you can see here from my scale hands here. Marked skill level 3. On the side, you can see they've got some markings for an F-4G with the 561st Nellis Air Force Base. What wing is that? AF-69-7295. And then we've got a F-4G Boise, Idaho, 190th Fighter Squadron, and Wild Weasel Frameless windscreen option. So it looks like there's a couple of different windscreen versions in the kit. On the opposite side are just some photos there of the finished kit. And we'll go ahead and crack her open. Very big box. So on the inside, you can see they've got it sectioned off with these little cardboardy things. But we'll go ahead and start removing some plastic here. Here's the what we were just talking about, the windscreen clear. And they've got a second piece in here for the other option, I believe. Looks pretty good. Nice and sealed up, which is good. They've got, trying to read some of the markings there, but some of the text here. We'll go ahead and open that up though and do photos. All right, so this is the first major piece of plastic. Obviously, we signed a fuselage of sides. We'll go ahead and open those up. So you can see some nice rivet detail and panel lines, all recessed, and get a look maybe on the video camera there for some of that. And it looks nice. Looks very clean. Production quality looks good. Connection points here on the bottom and rear and top of the vertical stabilizer. They have the, I'm not sure what this is called, but the obviously the flaring here is nice and very good detail there. Then we have a big, large group of screws. Alright, so on these we've got fuel tanks, mostly the cockpit base starter bit. We've got some, looks like some flaps or horizontal stabilizers, I'm not sure. Some of the jet outlet bits, and those look pretty thin, actually, but no idea that I assume that's accurate in terms of size. I'm kind of looking for production marks on here, but I don't actually see any dates or anything, so I was just curious. But again, looks very good. Modern level, obviously, tooling here. They did remove that center point, which I think is interesting. They also removed a section from the other piece, too. Wonder if that had anything on it. So I'm not sure whether this is a U.S. produced kit, this part of it anyways. I know the box appears to be, or this is a Revell Germany original kind of kit. Somebody could comment in the comment section. This next piece has some of the cockpit seats and the wheels, landing gear, which look pretty nicely detailed there. And just some more cockpit detail. Some of the fan rotors there, just kind of with a flat plastic plate there. But again, all nice production quality. Some of the armament, Sidewinder type missiles, air-to-air missiles, air-to-ground missiles, I'm sure some of them. This was, again, the plane was designed to take out like SAM missile batteries and things like that. And I'm just looking here to see if there's any dates, but it doesn't look like it. It does say it's made in Korea, actually. This plastic came from Korea. Interesting. I did not know Revell was outsourcing to Korea. Again, some of the, this looks like the air-to-ground missiles. And then some of the cockpit detail here, which looks nice. And, even all the mounting bits there look good. Highly technical words, bits. And then unless this last bag is the rest of the fuselage parts and parts we didn't see here. Now, again, some more cockpit optional bits here, so I'm not sure which ones are the real deal. Maybe they switch out based on that canopy change. But here's the front of the aircraft, and you can see again some nice panel lines there. If I can get the camera to cooperate, there we go. This underside piece also has some nice detail in it. Not seeing any serious production issues. There's some kind of weird plastic production, kind of, you can see that kind of like a zigzaggy mark there, but there's no actual, it's smooth, there's no actual issue with that. The nose of the plane is very nice, one piece, very thick, and looks good. And here we have the rear horizontal stabilizers, and again another bit of cockpit detail there. So lots of different cockpits here. All look similar, obviously, but so we're looking at probably parts that were included on several different variants. Not sure which is the G cockpit, but we'll try to figure that out at some point when I photograph it and just show you the G version. We'll take a look at the instructions. So the remainder of the wings detail and so forth. There's a nice raised section here, which is not sure that's unique to the G, but very nice. And the lower is a one-piece arrangement. So all looks very good. We have another bag of clear with cockpit stuff, so two of those in there. So maybe one is the different cockpit than the other one. So, and we've got one large sheet of decals, which, again, with Revell, does not come in a bag. And so this one does have the markings as indicated, like the Boise, Idaho, U.S. Air Force Phantoms, end of an era. Lots of little external markings there. Now this one's dated as 2014, but I believe this is when the kit was being designed, so it's just taking a little while for it to come out. And then we have the manual, which goes through, I'm sure, a step-by-step process here. Let's take a look. Lots of part listings. Cockpit detail, they're saying 270 and 271. I'll have to remember that. And then, again, just step by step with quite a few steps here. 17, 18, 20, 21, 22. And two different markings. And the location of the other various decal locations. They've even got some interesting reference art here on the back for this plane. So, all right, well, let's take a look at some photos and we'll come back, close-up detail parts, and we'll come back and conclude. Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed the photos of the new F-4G Phantom. Well, I say new, but as I said, I think it's been released and now been updated. But at least in terms of this version of it, it has now been re-released or as a new scheme kit in terms of the farewell edition. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them below. We'd like to thank Revell for sending us this sample copy. And again, if you have any input, we also be looking for someone to potentially do a build on this kit, which would be either a build review or a build feature. Features can be something maybe just concentrating on a specific aspect of the build. It could be an entire build process, but it doesn't have to be. And you can reach me at publisher@kitmaker.net if you're interested in doing that. So again, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time on Cracking the Box.